right. If you guys can find your seats, we have one more announcement for you guys before we start the service. All right. So great to see everyone greeting one another. Okay, so Harvest LA is going to revive a tradition that we have every year where we go to Hollywood Bowl to kind of see, certain people perform we used to do like Pixar and, also Star Wars, things like that. This year, we will be going to Chris Tomlin. Yeah. So he's going to have a night of worship at Hollywood Bowl on Saturday, May 4th. And there's going to be, he's the guy who's responsible for songs like How Great Is Our God and Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, and also Good Good Father. So, songs that we sing here. And also there's Pat Barrett and Torrin Wells. You might know Pat Barrett from the songs that we sing, Build My Life, and things like that. And Torrin Wells, you'll get to know him. So if you are interested, we will be going there, and we'll be sitting in like that blue area. And that's gonna be, for each ticket, it's gonna be $43. And if you're interested, please RSVP by February 10th in that tiny URL. So it's tinyurl.com/HarvestLA and then the date, 050419, okay? So, and if you have any questions, you can always come to me or you can email efcharvestla@gmail.com. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Yeah, it's going to be an exciting event. I'm hoping, my family can make it. So, do we have my slides? Yes. Well, again, good morning, sisters and brothers. I want to say Happy New Year, because, the Chinese New Year, the Lunar New Year, is in 2 days. So, if you were here last Sunday, our children ministry, they actually had a special activity for the Lunar New Year celebration. And, it's actually tomorrow is the real Lunar New Year's Eve. But because of the time difference, I guess for our friends and family in Asia, they're going to celebrate the New Year's Day already. But this is a time for family reunion. So it is definitely the most exciting season for people who have this cultural heritage in their families, even when we're here in the States. So I'm just wondering if you are familiar with the Lunar New Year decoration. Do you help out putting up something in your house? This is the slides I supposed to show. Yeah, this is the year of the pig. So last Sunday, if you were here, you might have seen lots of red color when you walk into the courtyard because the CM, the decorations. And in Chinese culture, red color symbolizes good fortune and joy. So it is also a symbolic color for happiness and blessing. So guess what the kids look forward to the most when the whole family is having this reunion on New Year's Eve? Nalai. Hongbao nalai. So, well, definitely the red envelope, huh? So when you visit the families or just simply traveled in Asia, have you ever seen this kind of red banners or the scrolls? In Mandarin, I think it's called Chunlian. Yeah, the spring couplet. Have you seen that? Anyone haven't seen something like that? I'll show you. This is it. Yeah, can you read it? Well, the writings are on it are usually, you know, oh, 家有福星高高照, right? 才如人意滚滚来. Yeah, pretty good. Which one? And the one on top is like 一帆风顺. So the writings are usually some, yeah, poetic or calligraphic arts like this. And even, you know, some Christians, they would do, yeah, the Christian version of this. And so, yeah, this is a very, very special culture, I guess, like in Asia. And you will see a lot if you go in this season especially. And there is a folk tale about the origin of this tradition that people with Chinese culture would put up the red spring couplet by their doors. And it's all started because of a monster called Nian, literally means ear. Well, this monster is a little too cute, actually, but I couldn't really find a better one to show you. So this monster, Nian, inhabited in the deep ocean, but only in the night of Lunar New Year's Eve, it would come to this village to hunt for food and even for humans. Every year, the villagers would have to escape or evacuate before Nian came by, and so they could go hide in the mountain. When Nian was around, it would start destroying many things, everything in the village, and ate up all the livestock, and then went back to the ocean before dawn. One year, a wise man came to this village and told them he knows how to handle this monster, Nian. They put a lot of red papers on their doors and walls because this man said Nian is afraid of red color. Also, they prepared many, many firecrackers because Nian is also afraid of light and noises. That year, the villagers were able to protect themselves from being harmed by Nian, the monster, with this trick. So they were just so relieved and filled joy. So since then, every year they put all these red papers on their doors and walls on Lunar New Year's Eve and enjoy the feast with their families inside the house. So this has become the tradition of 过年, to pass the year. Do I have another? But some scholars actually found this tradition could be related to the Jewish Passover. Because if we read Exodus 12, it describes how God told Moses and Aaron that they shall make the months of Passover the first month of the year. The Israelites shall prepare a lamb and enough food for the whole household on that day. And when they kill the lamb, they are supposed to put some of the blood on the side and top of the door frames. This is a sign to avoid the plague that God was going to strike down the firstborn of the Egyptian. So do you see all these parallels in the story of Nian and Passover, the first Passover? Even today, the Jewish people celebrate Passover to remember the liberation by God from their slavery in Egypt. And even the Last Supper for Jesus, the communion we do today, is the time Jesus and his disciples sat together and ate and drink at the occasion of Passover. Ethnically, we are not Jewish. Well, I don't know if any one of you have Jewish heritage, but with all these similarities, in both traditions, when we celebrate the Lunar New Year, it can be a great opportunity to think about God's grace in our life as well. So, yeah, let's read today's passage from Deuteronomy chapter 6, 3 to 9 all together. Let's read it. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your heart. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your house and your gate. Yes, this is the word of God. Deuteronomy is the fifth book in the Old Testament and one of the Jewish Torah. Torah means the law. Deuteronomy literally means the second law. It's from the Greek word deuteros and nomos, so it's the second in the law. But actually, even though the meaning of Deuteronomy, this book is the second law, it doesn't mean that it's a different law God has given to to Moses and the Israelites. The purpose of this book is to provide the interpretation once again on what God has taught his people in the law that was given to them at Mount Sinai so they can remember it. So do you remember the passage we read like two Sundays ago from Luke chapter 10 before the Good Samaritan story? When the expert in the law asked Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus asked him, what is written in the law? This expert answered with this quotation from today's passage, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. It is not too difficult to tell how important this commandment is for the Jews as well as for us today as Christians, because we know this is the greatest commandment from God. Today, I would like to share this message about the heritage of faith. And in today's passage, I have three insights to share with you regarding this sermon topic. The first one is God wants our attention. God wants our attention. In the beginning of both verse 3 and 4, it says, hear, Israel. Hear, O Israel. The Hebrew language for this is Shema Israel. Shema. I don't know if I have it. Oh, yeah. Shema. Well, you have to read from the right to the left. So it's Shema Israel. This is a very, very special indicator in Torah because this is where God wants the Israelites' attention. And to be honest, this is not just about the Israelites, but it's for each one of us. So when I read this passage, I wouldn't think that, oh, this is only for the people in Israel. So Moses wrote, hear, Israel. I believe God wants the attention from all of us. So Moses is actually telling us, hear, Jackie, hear, Charlotte, hear, Caleb, both Caleb, hear, Timothy. Yeah. So this is what God wants. He wants our attention because this is the greatest commandment from him. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. But then how? How do we love the Lord, our God, with all our heart, all our soul, and all our strength? Some people might ask, or might say, I go to church pretty much every Sunday to show my love and commitment to God. And this is great. It's definitely not easy to secure the time for God every Sunday, especially when we are in, you know, these days we have to juggle many things in our lives. At times we might prioritize something else instead of making our way to church because it's probably some rare event that you would participate maybe just once a life, and there's always church next week, next Sunday, and maybe, well, many more Sundays. But for all of us here in the church today, the more important thing is that when we come to church, what do we pay attention to? What do we pay attention to? When our service started, we worship and praise God with our singing voice and our hearts led by the worship team. But when we sing the worship songs, what are the things going on in your mind? Are we focused on God alone and giving him the glory he deserves? Or actually there are things distracting you from thinking of God? Sometimes it's not easy for ushers to focus even after, well, the worship starts, because there are people coming late, so I will excuse them. But even when you are sitting in the worship hall right now, where is your attention focused? Some research says, no matter a teenager or an adult, the average attention span for human beings is only about 10 to 20 minutes for full concentration. So something might pop into your head, or you would just suddenly recall something you forgot to do, and while listening to me. And that happens to me when I listen to others too. So it is really just how brains work. Well, if my phone like vibrates in my pocket, I would be distracted and want to see, whether it's an important notification popping up on the screen. So there are just too many things that can cut our attentions easily these days. I believe when Moses wrote this to the Israelites, telling them, "Hear, Israel, hear, O Israel, Shema Israel," he wanted to remind them that God's word is worth your attention. God's presence is worth our attention. Obeying these commandments to love the Lord our God with everything we have is a key to eternal life, according to the conversation between Jesus and the expert in the law. But then again, how do we love the Lord our God? I believe that it starts with paying attention to God's word. Do we prioritize God's word in our daily lives, even during the week? Do we tune in to God's word every morning before we start off our day? It's not easy. For the past few years, during my seminary days, the time I spent on Bible reading and devotions was very scattered, to be honest. Any time during the day, if I could find a slot, I would think, I should read the Bible. I should spend some quiet time with God. But from this year, 2019, I'm putting some more effort to begin the day with the Word of God. It's still not easy. In January, we had 31 days in January. Probably only one third of it, I was able to do my devotion with Living Life, the booklet we use first, and then I had to take Yosef to daycare. So, it's just not easy. It's just not easy to make time for God and really pay attention to his word. But there's a story I want to share. Back in 2011, I took 1 year off from my business career, and I actually went to a Christian music college called Nexus in England. My flatmate, Ben, told me a very insightful illustration, from his guitar tutor. He said, if life is as if you are playing music, you play your guitar, or whatever instruments you play violin or your piano, whatever musical instrument it is, what do you do before you start playing? What do you do for the violin players? For, I see Matthew over there. What do you do? I see the T sound, yeah. Tune your instruments. Yes, you want to tune your instruments and make sure all the notes you play will be in tune, right? Yeah, so it is the same. It's the same thing with your life. If you're going to start your day as if you're playing the music, you probably want to tune into God's word first. I believe this is also why God wants our attention to his word, so that we can tune in with him every single day. It is also mentioned in this passage, in verse 6, these commandments, which is God's word, that I give you today are to be on your heart. On your heart. What does that mean? The word should be on your heart. It means God wants us to remember. To remember his word. And remember what? When Moses said, these commandments I gave you today are to be on your heart. But what are, what exactly are these commandments? If we keep reading through the whole chapter 6 of Deuteronomy, there are several points we should keep in mind. Moses told the Israelites that you are about to go into this promised land God prepared for you. God swore to their ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So in verse 12, Moses said, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Why would Moses say this to the Israelites? They're going to this land flowing with milk and honey. They must be so grateful that they finally made their way there and to enjoy their lives after wandering the wilderness for 40 years. How could they forget the Lord, their God, who brought them out of Egypt? Did the Israelites forget the Lord when they were in the land of Canaan? Did they? I see some people nodding. They did. Yes, eventually they did. And why? Why did they forget? Why did they forget God? I believe that's because all the temptations. If we keep reading in verse 13, fear the Lord your God, serve him only, and take your oath in his name. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you. For the Lord your God, who is among you, is a jealous God, and his anger will burn against you, and he will destroy you from the face of the land. The Lord Yahweh, I am who I am. It's the Almighty God who brought the Israelites out from Egypt and delivered them from slavery. Also, he is the God who guided them to the promised land and took them into Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, with all this abundance. So what were those temptations made them derail from God's plan? They settled down. They stabilized with after 40 years of turmoil. They could finally enjoy life. They didn't have to eat manna and the quail, the bird, every single day ever. Now they can enjoy all kinds of food without worrying about experiencing hunger. Then the people of Israel started deviating away. And then they forgot about their God. They were just a little too comfortable. And they saw these people in Canaan worshiping their gods and just thinking, oh, those idols, I can see them. I can touch them. Why don't we try worshiping them and see if they can bring us something else? I don't know how many of you are the first generation, first Christian among your family, so the first generation Christian. But I think I've mentioned before that I was born in a Christian family. My grandfather, from my mom's side, was a pastor. And actually, my great-grandfather was a pastor too. And not only that, my mom has two sisters and one brother. Both sisters married pastors. And my uncle became a pastor and married his classmate from seminary, also a pastor. So basically, when we have a family reunion, it's a group of pastors. Well, lots of blessings, you know. And so growing in this Christian environment, this Christian family, in the church, makes me feel, well, I'm kind of born Christian. Yeah, because I learned to pray to God since I was little. I learned about Jesus and his stories in Sunday school. I kind of know the major Bible characters and their stories, and God as well. So I couldn't tell at what point I became a Christian, because I've been Christian like pretty much my whole life. It was actually a fascinating experience when I met my Christian friends at the campus fellowship in college when I was in Japan. Because a lot of them are the first generation Christians. And just by listening to their conversion stories and their testimonies of how their lives has been transformed and renewed after accepting Jesus into their lives as their Savior, I actually felt so envious, because back then I never had a moment or an experience like that. Even I called myself a Christian. But you know what? I want to make this statement. Not working. Uh-oh, is it? Probably run out of battery. Can we go to the next slide? Oh, God wants us to remember what? Remember how he saved us from our sins, just like how he saved the Israelites from Egypt. Being raised in a Christian family, I grew up in a relatively healthy and safe environment. I never had a very messed up life experience compared to some dramatic like testimonies you will hear, such as some Yakuza was saved and became a pastor and start sharing gospel with all these gangsters, or some who had issues with drug abuse later even became drug dealer. But because she encountered Jesus, her life was transformed and renewed, and now she's doing prison ministry to bring those criminals to God. Compared to their testimonies, the transformation of my life was more of a gradual process of realizing and responding to God's call. Of course, there have been signs, miracles, and lots of blessings in my life. So I believe God wants us to remember all these blessings and miracles he has given to us for a very important reason, which is God wants us to remember how he saved us from our sin, just like how he saved the Israelites from Egypt. What is your Egypt? You might find this question interesting, but which means, are you still captured in your sin and slavery? God will bring you out from Egypt if you can come to him, if you can repent on your sin and accept Jesus as a savior in your life. God wants us to remember, even, to remember our encounter with him so that we can experience this new life as a Christian, as a follower of Christ. And the last thing I want to share with you is God wants us to teach. This sounds more like for the parents, more for teachers or advisors, but it can be for our students, for every one of you. If you're going to serve the children that younger than you in Awana or in the BBS, or for the short-term mission trip this year, in verse 7 to 9, it says, impress them, which is God's commandment, God's words, on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your forehead. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. You will see three methods of how you teach your children in these three verses. First, if we want to impress God's words on your children, we have to talk about it all the time, pretty much all the time, right? It says, when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, you lie down and get up all the time. You want to talk about that all the time. So maybe we should think about how we would answer the questions below. Do you talk about God's word with your children? Do you read the Bible together with your family? Do you share the inspiration you receive from the devotion of the day with people around you? This is very important. And the second one is, if we want to impress God's word on our children, we need to put it on their hands and bind the scripture on their foreheads. Some of you might laugh when you hear this, but this is what the Jewish people literally do. Can you see this? Do you see something on their head? And their own. This is a prayer box they call Teflin, and they literally put it on their forehead, and it's like a scroll, like, you know, like the tape in it, and can put it out and just bind that on their hands. I was fascinated when I saw they're literally doing this to their children, and even seeing the one on the right is a soldier, you know, with the Jewish head. They are really devoted, and it's definitely a way to remind your children or yourself to read the Word of God. Well, people might find it embarrassing, but if everyone does that in our church, I guess it's pretty okay, right? Even, you know, they even write scriptures on the door frames of our houses and gates, and this sounds a bit like putting the spring couplets, the red banners on the top and the side of the door, like for Lunar New Year. So, I mean, like the ones I showed to you, you may put like, oh, the Lord is my shepherd, or the Lord is my strength, and those scriptures, like for each month on the calendars the church passed out end of last year. So if you can see it, you would read it. And if you read it, you will remember it. So that's the second one. And the last method is really to practice God's word. In verse 20 to 21 of Deuteronomy chapter 6, in the future, when your son asks you, what is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws that the Lord our God has commanded you? The children ask the parents, what is the meaning of the Lord, of the word of God? supposed to tell them, tell him, "We were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand." So when your children came to you and asked, "Mom, Dad, how did you become a Christian?" Be ready for it. It is not about your Bible knowledge, not about whether you know Hebrew language or not, not about how many Bible verses you have memorized, but it is about how to share your own testimony, how to share your own stories, telling them how God has saved you from the sin. So now you're free from it, and now you are a joyful person. This is why identifying the Egypt in our lives will help. We all need God's salvation, God's liberation to bring us out of sins. And again, the key is to recognize our sin and repent in front of God so that God will be able to transform us, to renew our lives. These 3 points I shared, God wants our attention, God wants us to remember His word, and God wants and how He saved us, and God wants us to teach our children, are so crucial because it is an art where when we pray, we pay attention to God's commandments and remember how we encountered with God. So now we have this new life. And most importantly, God would like us to teach our children, our next generation, by talking about His word and the good news, constantly reminding ourselves with physical signs of the scripture and telling them our own stories, our own testimonies. Sometimes our children don't even have to listen to our testimonies because they will see how we cherish our lives in our daily life anyway. Do we pray together with our children? Do we read the Bible together with our family? Do we build the family altar at home to worship God and bless one another? When we think of passing along the heritage of faith to the next generation, when we think of parenting, we would like to be reminded that we need to pay attention to God's word, and we need to remember our encounter with Jesus. And this new identity as a Christian, as child of God, we can truly teach our children, the next generation, with our own testimony. And I believe this is the art of parenting. To wrap up today's message, one thing I'd like to remind all of us is that even if my parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents are Christian, so I probably call myself a third or fourth generation Christian, I still need to have a personal relationship. I still need to have a personal encounter with my Father in heaven. It doesn't matter if your dad or mom is a pastor, an elder, a deacon, a church leader, a co-worker of church, or a professor at the seminary. It doesn't guarantee that you will inherit their faith. Unless you truly encounter God, encounter Jesus in your life through prayers, through the Word of God, in the trial, in the hardship in your lives, you might not be able to experience God's work and the purpose He has for your life. So there's a saying, God doesn't have grandchildren. That means each one of us should be child of God, not grandchild. We do not become Christian through our parents or grandparents. Nope. We all should be the first generation Christian because this is how we can confirm our identity, how we can confirm our relationship with God, with our Father in heaven. We're children of God, for God is our Father. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for being our Heavenly Father. Thank you for making each one of us your child so that we can have this identity as sisters and brothers in Christ. Thank you for saving us from our sins, like how you brought the Israelites out from Egypt so we don't have to be in slavery because of our sins anymore. Lord, help us hear and obey your commandments, your words. Help us pay attention to your voice each and every day so that we will remember how we encountered with you, with your Son Jesus. Because of your love and grace, we are saved. So now we can enjoy this new life and new identity in your family. Lord, help us and give us wisdom so that we know how to teach our children, the next generation, with our speech and action. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you have poured onto our life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I would like to invite Elder Sheila and Pastor Eddie for the time of Holy Communion. You should know that the Last Supper Jesus had with his disciples was the celebration of Passover. It is quite meaningful that today, right before the Lunar New Year, we're able to have this communion to remember how Jesus redeemed our sins with his life, his own life on the cross. So let us prepare our heart. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And he gave thanks. He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this wherever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Now I would like to invite our church members, those who has been baptized in EFC church or any other Christian denominations, to come forward to partake this communion all together. Remember to take the bread and the cup and return to your seat. When everyone's got the bread and cup in hand, we'll partake it all together. And as we wait until the time we partake this bread and drink the cup all together, I would like to invite all of us, when you get back to your seat, to close your eyes and ponder, what should I repent when my heart is still in exile? Jesus has paid the cost, sacrificing his own life on the cross for each one of us. He died for our sin, our sin and repent on it. We have no connection with Jesus. As we confess our sin and repent in front of God, we rejoice for the forgiveness and salvation. Thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's partake together. After supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us drink it all together. To come forward. This is the time for us to worship in tithes and offering, and it is time we give a portion of what God has provided in our life back to Him for His ministry. It is also a time to remember what we have. It's all from God, because when we first came to this world, we had nothing in our hands. As we leave this world, we carry nothing away. God's blessings are abundant for those who are faithful in giving with a grateful heart. For those who are not working or having no incomes at the moment, I would like to encourage you to think about how you can offer your time, your prayer, your service, and your dedication to God's ministry.
Respond to the song Made to Worship.
Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. May the Lord have your attention to his word. Lord, make you remember how you